you know, thanks Phillips for, you know, getting me between you again. We would discuss a fairly common problem, and I think this is was a good suggestion that we should do a thing which is very commonly seen rather than discussing about rare things like LA strain or stuff like that. So what is dilated cardiomyopathy? Now, dilated cardiomyopathy is a myocardial disorder or a dysfunction of a systolic nature which produces a dilated left ventricle, which is about 17% more dilated than the normal, and the ejection fraction is less than 45. In fact, we should take it about less than 50, but there is a debate. I don't want to go into that controversy, but the main issue is that if you have dilated LV, if you have a poor ejection fraction, but you do not have coronary artery disease, you do not have hypertension or valvular heart disease or a congenital heart disease causing this problem. So this becomes a kind of an idiopathic abnormality, so-called, for a dysfunction of the predominantly left ventricle, but you know, both ventricles for that matter. Of late, we are seeing a new entity where the LV is not dilated, but it has a poor function. The ejection fraction is less than 40% or 45%, but it is not dilated. So by technically, I cannot call it as a dilated cardiomyopathy, and there is no hypertension, there is no other association. So what do I call it? So this new terminology is hypokinetic non-dilated cardiomyopathy, and this is in the guideline. So HNDC is the new terminology where you have ejection fraction low, but LV hasn't dilated as yet. It would dilate as the time passes. But many of us will see patients where you have a doubt of a regional wall motion abnormality. So, you know, I follow this dictum. I write that the possibility that this patient has a dilated cardiomyopathy, but it could be possibly ischemic, or in case I am, you know, reasonably have a more doubt about ischemia, I say most likely ischemic. But the terminology ischemic cardiomyopathy is not liked by many, because cardiomyopathy basically means myocardial disorder and should not be secondary to hypertension or coronary artery disease. Obviously, the very first thing in a disorder where there is a systolic dysfunction, we need to make an assessment of ejection fraction. This formula fails drastically, not because there are regional issues, but the problem is that the heart becomes globular. Now, the basic formula of a bullet form in M mode actually goes off. If I tell you my experience from fetal echocardiography, the very first thing happens is the global, there is a rounding of the heart or the LV. It becomes more globular than bullet shaped in the fetus, and we have a sphericity index, like we have a sphericity index in adult echo. So that actually comes first. Then there is an abnormality of the TAI index and the strain patterns, and then there is an abnormality of ejection fraction or fraction shortening. So rounding of the apex becomes first to happen. I just want to give you a small tip, a shortcut for ejection fraction, that in case this is a very good utility of a mode which is actually dying now. Now you put the M mode cursor here at the tips of AML and a PML, and this is the interventricular septum on a parasternal long axis view. And you see the E and A waves of the mitral valve on an M mode. And you see the E point separation from the septum. So this is called E point septal separation. The distance between the E point and the septum is EPSS. Normally is less than 7. And in case it's more than 10 or more than a centimeter, it indicates that LV functions are abnormal, but there are certain things where this is not applicable. For example, if you have aortic regurgitation, which would move the mitral leaflet down, if you have an LBB, septum would not contribute. And if you have an anterior wall infarction, again, the septum would not contribute. or you have a mitral stenosis where mitral valve is unable to open. So all these situations, the EPSS is not good. Otherwise, EPSS gives you a fair degree of a sensitivity, specificity of an ejection fraction, a very simple, quick rule. And in case the EPSS is more than 1.3 centimeter, then it is highly likely that patient has ejection fraction of less than 35. I show you this case. Now, E-point septal separation is 14 millimeter. And this clearly tells you that this patient has ejection fraction less than 35%. I don't think so. We should all believe in visual ejection fraction. But unfortunately, eyeballing is still continued. And what we do is that we do eyeballing and we presume ejection fraction is about 30%. And then we continue to take repeated measurements of the LV in systole and diastole for a Simpson formula till tallies with our eyeballing. So that's another bias which we generally have. But eyeballing is not an accurate method, particularly in an ejection fraction between 40 and 50, it's very, very erroneous. Less than 35 ejection fraction is fairly okay. This graph where eyeballing was done by three or four observers, and look at the green observer or a physician repeatedly have measured the ejection fraction on the lower side, while the other red one and pink, they overestimated ejection fraction. So there is no standardization in eyeballing. The Simpson, biplane Simpson is the best method where we trace the endocardium and then we put the discs in the space and we know the height of the disc and we know the dimensions of the disc and then we calculate the volume, systolic volume and a diastolic volume, and then we calculate ejection fraction and diastolic volume divided by systolic one, divided by end diastolic volume and 100. And this gives me the ejection fraction in percentage. Remember something, in dilated cardiomyopathy, this kind of situation is not very unusual. You would see lot of trabeculations. You might call it non-compaction, but then you have to fulfill the criteria. This does fulfill the criteria, but even many patients would not have a non-compaction, but would have markedly increased trabeculation, particularly in dilated cardiomyopathy. Maybe the LV was compact, and now when it's dilated, all those channels actually have opened up. Now the issue comes here is that once you're tracing an endocardium, you must be sure, please do not trace the endocardium excluding the trabeculation. These trabeculations have to be excluded. We just take measurement at the level of a compact myocardium. Okay. Now, Simpson formula also has a problem. Let's say if I see only four chamber view and a two chamber view, so my ejection fraction would be reasonably okay. I should call it around 40 to 50%. But if I include parasternal long axis view now, as there is a regional wall motion normality, the ejection fraction is going to be low. So the two-dimensional method, again, would not be appropriate. But I still believe that we are now moving into the direction of a three-dimensional ejection fraction. And it takes precisely 18 seconds to do this kind of calculation once you've acquired volume. And this has a very wonderful correlation with the gold standard, that is the cardiac MRI. So three-dimensional echo should be the best. Now, what do we all want to know from a dilated cardiomyopathy, about dilated cardiomyopathy? I think the very first thing I would like to know, am I missing a treatable cause? And after 6 months, I come to know I should have given something else. Am I on the right track and treating appropriately? So if I start a treatment, what do I expect after 6 months or a year? What is the chance of recovering ejection fraction or a patient going downhill course? Is the patient high risk to go into a downhill course or development of sudden cardiac arrest. So this is very, very important. So then if I have an LBB and I want to know which my patient would it benefit from CRT? And, you know, do I need to screen family members? Is it idiopathic, a dilated cardiomyopathy, or there is some genetic basis for this? So let's take this topic one by one. And the very first thing what we do is that, is my patient a high risk category? So we all have seen patients, those who would have a very diverse kind of an outcome. Many patients would be largely remain asymptomatic, would not actually go into deterioration and, you know, improve ejection fraction. For that matter, we have seen patients of ejection fraction of 20% or even less than 20% doing regular jogging, walking, golf. And then there are patients, those who have ejection fraction of about 30%, 35%, or even 40%. Those are very symptomatic and they have a repeated hospitalization and they have a risk of dying suddenly by a cardiac death. So how do we actually make an assessment? There are, you know, more than 20 parameters for a prognostication, but I don't think so. I would be going into all those details, but I would focus on very, very specific and the latest developments in prognostic markers of heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. E2E prime, you know, is very important. LV inflow is very important. Pulmonary artery hypertension is very important in assessment of, but those are things which you already know. I'm touching the areas which are new. GLS, thrombus, obviously it makes hell of a difference whether you have a thrombus, and a functional MR in a current scenario when we can actually take care of a mitral regurgitation by mitral valve clip. So we need to know, and that is a kind of help we can do. LA size and function are now being thought very, very critically important. RV function, it is said that if you have an LV dysfunction, look at the RV. And today, I do not know how many of us are reporting right ventricular functions in dilated cardiomyopathy. Cardiac MRI, I would just touch that because that's not my specialty. Now, GLS. To tell you the truth, if you take an E wave, EA ratio, you know, and volumes by end-diastolic dimensions, the GLS is fairly stable. The error, chance of error is still less than 10%, which is very, very good despite a lot of hue and cry on a inter-vendor variability of GLS. This has been kind of standardized now with the effort of Dr. Badana. Now, if you have a GLS and if you divide into three tertiles of GLS, the people, those who have a low GLS would have a higher risk of mortality. And the cutoff limit, let's say if I take a roughly less than 10, would have a very, very high risk of mortality. And this is the probability of hospitalization in case you have a GLS, which is less than 10 or less than 9. Why I'm showing this is a concept which is coming ahead in two slides. Heart moves in this type and it has a longitudinal motion. It has a circumferential motion and it has a squeeze. And if I may tell you that the longitudinal fibers, they contribute to 15% of the ejection fraction, circumferential about 30%, but these spiral fibers which produce longitudinal as well as twist have a contribution to the 60% of. So if you have a spiral fibers which are affected somehow in dilated cardiomyopathy, your ejection fraction would fall far more and the prognosis would be worse. I'm going to show you what I meant by that. Now, in an MRI, this is one of the very new things that in case you have a late gadolinium enhancement, LGE, in the mid-myocardium, mid myocardium, which indicates LGE indicates that there is a fibrosis. So if you have a fibrosis in mid myocardium, this is not ischemic. Ischemic happens in the subendocardium. Mid myocardial fibrosis is the worst prognosis, both for sudden cardiac arrest and repeated hospitalization and progression of the disease. Why? Now, I told you that torsion contributes significant to the ejection fraction. If you have a normal torsion, the torsion, this is the normal torsion, apex moves in a different direction and base moves in another direction. Even if we have a reverse torsion sometimes seen in LBB, there is some torsion to improve the ejection fraction. But in case there is a mid-myocardium fibrosis, heart cannot have that squeeze movement. The apex cannot afford to move against the base because they are all working as a fixed piece. So with the fibrosis in the mid-myocardium, this is called a rigid body movement. And this is the patient group of patients which have been seen recently to have a very high mortality. And these are the patients, those who are non-responders on the CRT. And the recommendation is that these are patients are likely to have higher risk of sudden cardiac arrest and should be given an ICD. So we've discussed one. So let's come to the thrombus. Let me tell you, a very vigorous search for the thrombus has to be done because thrombus actually changes the entire scenario. You know, you suddenly start another therapy that is an anticoagulation, whether it's a NOVAC or the previous ones. This is the patient where it was the apex was foreshortened. You improve your view and the apex, you can see thrombus at the apex. And many a time you can see the thrombus in an unusual place that is close to the mitral annulus. But a good search is required to see the thrombus. And in case not very clear, it can go to unusual view, the two chamber view, you can see a large thrombus. This is something, this is different than a blood cyst because blood cyst is usually at the valves and all the thrombi actually dissolve first in the center. Okay, the resolution starts from the center rather than our old concept that thrombus starts dissolving from outside, starts becoming smaller and smaller and smaller. That is one of the mechanisms, but not the major one. But thrombus starts dissolving in the middle. So spontaneous echo contrast. And you move your probe and go to little unconventional views, and then you see a very large thrombus with the central lucency. So we've discussed these two, and the third one, functional mitral regurgitation. Once you have a dilated LV, the papillary muscle is still maintained and the chordae are of the same length, and the coaptation of the mitral valve is maintained. But if you have a dilatation of an LV, the papillary muscles move apart, the chordae get tensed up, and the mitral valve is unable to close because of this tenting act of this tethered chordae. So this would produce an regurgitation orifice, and there would be a mitral regurgitation. So for mitral regurgitation, if the ejection fraction is less than 30%, sorry to say, and there is a severe MR, we have a new technique that is called a mitral valve clip. What do we do in a mitral valve clip? This is the site from left, this animation is from the left atrium, and we are entering from the left atrium into the left ventricle through the mitral valve. And then after advancing through the mitral valve, we come back and then we try to close the clip, but there was an MR. We go back again, try another site. And then we try to put the clip on. There is no mitral regurgitation. What we have done that we have created two orifices, then the single orifice. And this reduces mitral regurgitation drastically. So now there are two trials which were done. Now this is how the clip then the deployment lead is taken out, and this is how it works. The two trials, one is MITRA FR trial, which was a kind of a negative trial. They did not show any improvement in mortality, morbidity in a patient where the mitral valve clip was done, but they chose the wrong patients. The right patient should be, the ejection fraction has not fallen less than 30%. It's not severe mitral dysfunction, but there is a severe mitral regurgitation. To put a statement again, I can say, if the mitral regurgitation is kind of out of proportion to LV dilatation, this is a group of patients where, and the patient has to be symptomatic, where mitral valve clip shows benefit, COAPS showed it. A brief one or two slides on the left atrial size. It's a very, very important predictor of future cardiovascular event. You have a clinical data, you have a clinical and ejection fraction, you have clinical systolic, and you add E to E prime, EA ratio, and plus over top you add L left atrial volume index. All cause mortality is statistically significantly high. Similarly, if you have LA max, which is increased markedly more than 68 ml, then it has a 3.8 higher adverse outcome from same dilated cardiomyopathy. So please do not forget LA size. It is a good idea to mention LA size. You can do it on a 2D, or I mean, there are now methods like in heart model, you can show the LA volume in 3D. The normal LA volume is less than 35 meters per square meters. And for both males and female, it's the same. If it is more than that, then we can. Now, the left atrial strain, actually, if you do a strain, it becomes abnormal before the LA volume increases. And there are a couple of studies recently done which show that LA strain is an important prognosticator, but still we do not have a validation of left atrial strain to that level, and we do not have guidelines. We continue to do LA strain, but we still waiting for authentication from the guidelines. RV function. I told you, whenever you have an LV dysfunction, look at the RV. You would have patients of ejection fraction. This is almost a similar ejection fraction to around 30%. But if you notice here in this patient, which is fairly an old recording, about 3-4 years old, and this RV is not contracting well. This RV is small and it's contracting normally. This patient is far less symptomatic than this one. The progression of the disease and the symptoms is far lower in patients, those who have a normal or at least one good ventricles contracting. So there are, if you use a TAPSE as a marker of the right ventricle function, and if you have a TAPSE which is on the lower side, it actually indicates that the cumulative survival is less. Now, if you have a using an ejection fraction of an RV less than 30%, or in this study less than 20% ejection fraction, clearly showed the difference between the mortality and hospitalization in patients with dilated cardiomyopathy. So LA volume and RV contractility, ejection fraction, and which parameter to use. These two parameters are fairly simple, TAPSE and S-wave pulse Doppler, that is on a annular Doppler. They indicate the same thing. They are not different. Fraction area shortening and the strain are different. So if you have a fractional area shortening which is less, or strain is less, that means there are RV dysfunctions. So we've discussed that, and let's come down to an MRI. I give you an example of a diabetic cardiomyopathy where you have a fibrosis as a key component, which starts fairly early in the onset of dilated cardiomyopathy. And what it does is that you can see that the E prime becomes smaller. But how do you detect this fibrosis? The detection of this fibrosis is very easy with an MRI. You have a mid myocardial fibrosis by LGE. And if you have an LGE positive versus LGE negative, now the survival is different. Hospitalization is different. Not only that, LGE would be able to pick up certain diseases like amyloid, Fabry, sarcoidosis, and it can actually pick up a subtle ischemic cardiomyopathy, because if you get a subendocardial LGE enhancement, that indicates that there is a subendocardial infarct, and this is an ischemic cause, and then we might go ahead with a coronary angiography. So what is the probability that, you know, my patient would recover from ejection fraction? So there are three things: whether there's a full remission, or patient deteriorates, or patient recovers. So let's discuss if patient recovers. Now, these are the cardiomyopathies. I would like to discuss few of them as a specific cardiomyopathy in subsequent talk. Now, Takotsubo cardiomyopathy recovers almost all. Peripartum cardiomyopathy, we always have a conception they all recover, they all don't. There is a sizable number of patients which do not recover from a peripartum cardiomyopathy. Same is true for myocarditis. Alcohol cardiomyopathy, you remove the alcohol or offending agent and give thiamine, likely that it would improve. Tachycardia-induced cardiomyopathy is another area where you can expect about full recovery in 80% of the patients. And patients with hyper or hypothyroidism or metabolic disorders recover by correction of the disorders. But let's forget about those quick recoveries. I'm talking about an idiopathic cardiomyopathy. What happens there? Now, in 2016, we had heart failure definition, that heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, EF less than 40. We had a category of preserved ejection fraction. And there was an introduction of another category, that minimally reduced ejection fraction, that is between 40 to 49 ejection fraction. We intend to add another category, heart failure with improved ejection fraction. That the ejection fraction was low, now it has improved more than 40%, or heart failure with recovered ejection fraction, that ejection fraction has normalized. Does this happen? Yes, it does happen, and you have seen patients occasionally. Now, these are the group of patients which were followed for about 6 years. And after a yearly echocardiogram, you could see 23% patient had an improved ejection fraction, and 14% patients had heart failure with recovered ejection fraction. That's a new terminology. I'm showing this cartoon again. Why? Because to make you understand, when we had dilated cardiomyopathy to begin with, or we had an onco-related damage, the longitudinal fibers were first affected. And by affection of a longitudinal fibers, the ejection fraction was maintained. Ejection fraction started falling only when circumferential and helical fibers were involved. And we presume that if recovery happens, it would happen in the reverse manner. The helical fibers would recover, circumferential would fiber recover, and probably there would be a stage where ejection fraction would be normal, but you would still have a subclinical systolic dysfunction because longitudinal fibers have not recovered. And this you would be able to pick up if you do a global longitudinal strain. Now, heart failure with recovered ejection fraction, actually about 40% of the patients, those who have improved or recovered ejection fraction, they relapse despite on a full treatment. 60% relapse if you stop treatment. So now if you use GLS as criteria, if GLS is more than 16, now the chances are that the patient would not relapse. And in case GLS is low, the same thing which I was trying to tell you, GLS indicates the longitudinal fibers are still involved. It is just a subclinical normal ejection fraction. There is subclinical systolic dysfunction. And 62% patient would again go back to the relapse. So the lesson here is, do not stop medicine even if the ejection fraction becomes normal in idiopathic dilated cardiomyopathy, unless you know a specific cause like alcohol or a peripartum cardiomyopathy or a tachycardia. So do not stop. The heart failure medicine has to continue indefinitely. So am I missing a treatable cause? There are certain treatable causes. I would show you few anecdotes, few cases, but then you have an amyloid which can be suspected. If you have a transient variety, then carpal tunnel syndrome, you have a left ventricular hypertrophy, a typical cherry on the top on longitudinal strain. Then many a times you've seen patients where you treat this patient as a dilated cardiomyopathy, you continue the treatment and suddenly the blood pressure starts rising. And after about a month or so, even if you are giving medicines like ACE inhibitors and beta blockers and diuretic, which are supposed to be antihypertensive, blood pressure rather than falling starts increasing. Because as the LV functions improve, the patient is going back to the original hypertensive state. And this, I call it as a truncated hypertension. Patient had hypertension till the time when the ejection fraction fell, the LV systolic function fell, and heart was unable to maintain that high blood pressure. Sarcoidosis, Fabry's, these are the kind of disorders which you must look for. And the general clue is that any regional valve motion abnormality, any left ventricular hypertrophy, valve thickening or interatrial septum thickening or atrial wall thickening are kind of a markers of these disorders. So these are the red flags which you have an AV block, sinus bradycardia, left ventricular hypertrophy, and in sarcoidosis you have a regional valve motion abnormality in which it doesn't fit in any coronary artery disease territory, you start suspecting, or there is a thinning, you start suspecting sarcoidosis. I want to make a special mention here about dilated cardiomyopathy. The type is dilated cardiomyopathy during pregnancy. All cardiomyopathies during pregnancy are not peripartum cardiomyopathy. Patient could be having an LV dysfunction, which could have been a subclinical, and there was a number of patients which they have seen, about 15 to 20% of the patients had genetic mutations which were responsible, and only pregnancy overload unmasked the dilated cardiomyopathy. There is a very thick association with peripartum cardiomyopathy and a previous use of chemotherapy and a radiotherapy. These are secondly, there is a new trend which we are learning now, that patient with peripartum cardiomyopathy are at a higher risk of developing cancer in the future. So we are started doing a screening. So in case patient had chemotherapy in the past and now the pregnancy is being planned, this pregnancy has to be meticulously monitored with a regular echocardiography. Then there is a cardiomyopathy called pregnancy associated, which the peripartum cardiomyopathy by definition happens in last gestational time, that is about a month from before the delivery, and can appear within 6 months after the delivery is done. This is something new which I thought I would share with you. This concept was given long back. Now this concept is taking shape. In the peripartum cardiomyopathy, it is suggested that there is a genetic predisposition. This is one. This is very, very important. There is in South Africa, the incidence is high. In many countries, incidence of peripartum cardiomyopathy is low. This can be explained on the basis of a genetic predisposition. Now, prolactin is a hormone which continues to increase and increases dramatically because this is required for lactation. Now it starts after about 30-35 weeks and peaks somewhere here and then continue to rise after the delivery. Now it is recognized that the prolactin gets degraded by this component into a smaller component, 16K component, which is a component of prolactin. Prolactin is not harmful to the heart, but this component is. This degradation of prolactin to this actually produces vessel damage, produces a myocardial damage with the complex mechanism, and all has been already validated. And if we give bromocriptin, which stops production of a prolactin, we can expect an improvement. So in a peripartum cardiomyopathy, we continue with the same standard heart failure treatment. Obviously, in pregnancy, you can't give spironolactone, you can't give ACE inhibitor or ARB, but you can give hydralazine instead. But after the delivery, you can choose the ACE inhibitor and should be safe for a lactating mother. Now, the bromocriptin can be used, and it has been shown in a couple of studies. We do not have a guideline as yet, but they say that if you use bromocriptin for 2 weeks or 8 weeks to make the same improvement, there is an improvement in ejection fraction, there is a reduction of death, NYHA class, and ejection fraction improvement if you give bromocriptin. So that was something new. Now, if the patient has had peripartum cardiomyopathy, then are we going to suggest the next pregnancy? When are we going to stop the therapy? This is a rough checklist. Again, this is not a guideline. This is a recent paper, 2019, which says that if the ejection fraction is less than 55, this is high risk. Please do not attempt anything. Okay, continue the same therapy. If ejection fraction is more than 55, then you can perform a stress test. Okay. Perform a stress test, and in case there is a normal hyperdynamic response, the blood pressure increases and you have a normal contractility, then you can think that this is a relatively low risk patient, and you know, you can consider a pregnancy, okay, with a caution. But in case there is a blunted response, again, all these categories, you should not consider pregnancy at all and continue treatment till ejection fraction improves by 55% and the stress echo shows an hyperdynamic response. Alcohol cardiomyopathy, there's nothing very great, so I'm not going to discuss it in great length. Just one slide, that if you take a very huge quantity of alcohol and you take it for 5 to 10 years, causes a damage, and they are more likely to be having arrhythmias than other idiopathic cardiomyopathy. So ICD should be liberal consideration there. And many of them would have a thiamine deficiency, or B1 supplementation by intramuscular route would be a good choice. And it has been shown in a couple of studies of improvement of ejection fraction, even in non-alcoholic cardiomyopathies. Tachycardia, and they're very interesting. Egg first or chicken first or hen first. Now, tachycardia-induced cardiomyopathy, you know that multiple ventricle ectopics and intermittent VT, that's a news, they can cause cardiomyopathy. This is called tachycardia. Multiple ventricle ectopics, more than 10% of the normal beats, in case they are there in Holter, they can cause dilated cardiomyopathy. And dilated cardiomyopathy is multiple ventricle ectopics and VT. So which comes first? We do not know. But we need to know, this is something very, very important. If I treat tachyarrhythmia, so the dilated cardiomyopathy almost recovers. So, I mean, it's, you have to keep a threshold on the lower side. In case there is more than 10% of the VPCs of the normal beats, or there are multiple ventricular episodes of short runs of ventricular tachycardia, ill sustained, EP study should be considered. And if catheter ablation can be done, should be done, and with a hope that ejection fraction in this category would improve. Malnutrition produces cardiomyopathy. Vitamin B deficiency can produce that. Lot of hormonal imbalance, hypothyroid, and thyrotoxicosis they can produce cardiomyopathy, but generally these are the mild cardiomyopathy, except for hyperthyroidism or thyrotoxicosis, where LV ejection can fall drastically. This is the patient with the hypothyroidism. You can notice the pericardial effusion, a mild LV dysfunction, and left ventricle hypertrophy. All these things improved after appropriate therapy. Couple of interesting cases before we wind up. This is the patient where you can see the LV is dilated. There is a mild mitral regurgitation. LA is enlarged. And as I told you, start looking at the RV. Please start looking at the RV. RV is good. RV is small and RV is good. So, you know, if after the lecture, if you start looking at the RV in dilated cardiomyopathy, I think that the purpose of my talk is done. So look at LA and look at RV. Two things. So LA is markedly enlarged. And here you see again the LV contractility. You do have some kind of regional wall motion abnormality here and maybe at the apex, but they're not very glaring. Look at the aortic valve opening. It is opening not singular. It is opening like the mitral valve is opening. So that means there is a mid-systolic closure in between, which indicates a low ejection fraction. So this was a patient where we saw a very large right coronary artery. This is slightly angled parasternal short axis view at the aortic level, aortic valve level, and you can see a dilated right coronary artery with an increased flow. And then if you see on apical long axis view and on two chamber view, you can see markedly increased arteries, possibly the posterior descending and circumflex artery, which have increased flow. Finally, all that flow comes back from to the left coronary artery, which drains into the pulmonary artery. So this is anomalous origin of left coronary artery from pulmonary artery. The blood goes from right coronary artery to all coronary circulation into the coronary circulation through collaterals, and the left coronary artery is again markedly dilated and opens into, but this becomes a left to right shunt and produces myocardial ischemia. And that was the reason of that patient's having low ejection fraction. It was not dilated cardiomyopathy. A child 2 months old had a difficulty in feeding and perspiration, and this is what we get. Ejection fraction to the tune of about 20% with the severe mitral regurgitation. And if I do a suprasternal view, now you see sudden narrowing here at the aorta, and there is a continuous kind of flow and aliasing at 82 centimeter per second. And this is a coarctation of aorta. Coarctation of aorta, you can see in a apical two chamber view, if you angle it slightly, you can see the descending aorta here, and you can see a continuous flow across this coarct segment. So in a child, you must rule out coarctation diligently in case you are looking at poor ejection fraction. Again, if you see this, this ventricle is hypokinetic, this ventricle is hypokinetic, and this ventricle is normal. But guess what? If you look closely, the tricuspid valve here, this is the tricuspid valve, which is lower. And this, in fact, is the right ventricle. This is the left ventricle. This is the patient of congenitally corrected transposition. A non-compaction is another entity which we can see. This is a non-compaction, and this is the sponge like LV you can see. And in fact, you see the LV close to the apex is not moving at all. It's not producing any contraction. There is just spongy myocardium here. And you all know this is called non-compaction. You put the Doppler on, you can see the blood going through the recesses. So let me tell you the non-compaction, the arrhythmogenic right ventricular hyperdystrophy, which is, produces arrhythmia and dilated cardiomyopathy, and occasionally the hypertrophied cardiomyopathy, share a similar genes. Okay, the genetic problem is same in patients, those who have non-compaction and dilated cardiomyopathy. So would the patient benefit from CRT? A lot of parameters in echo have come, but still ECG is the gold standard. And we have seen if you get this kind of rocking movement of the apex towards the lateral wall, this septal splash and apical rocking is a very favorable sign. This is the patient, if you see, would improve after, and this patient does have a broad QRS, would improve by CRT. There are many other techniques of looking at a GLS. These are the recent trials which show that septal and basal lateral segment, in case they show certain abnormalities, I would not dwell it here. Now, is it idiopathic dilated cardiomyopathy? About a third of patients, which is quite surprising, would have a genetic link. So there is a genomic association of dilated cardiomyopathy, particularly the familial one, and we have an advanced, the human genome has been mapped, and this thing can be done very, very easily. It isn't very expensive. Initially, it used to cost a lot. Now it costs about 15,000 to 20,000 rupees to get entire genomic analysis done. And there are panels available for dilated cardiomyopathy, where the panel is that they look for few specific genes and gene variables. ECG many a times can give you a clue. So this is one slide you can click it for your future resource. If you have an LBB, this is meant for CRT, but these are the kind of genetic abnormalities which can be associated with the ECG patterns, AV block. Apart from the cardiac sarcoid, you can have these kind of genetic disorders in case you have an AV block. In case you have a short PR interval, that indicates a Fabry's disease. In case you have a Q wave, I think let me show you a few ECGs. So that's one ECG, which is a left axis deviation, so left anterior hemi block, and you see a first degree AV block. The PR interval is prolonged. Look at the V4, look at the L2. There is a PR interval is about 7 small squares, so it's prolonged, and this indicates this laminal abnormality on a genetic variant. In case you see these kind of ECGs, all the more reason you must genetic workup. A T wave changes of this nature in the lateral leads with the poor voltage in the anterior leads or a frontal lead, this indicates a lot of fibrosis has happened. Normally, you would have expected large voltages here. If you get a poor voltage graph, this again indicates a genetic association. A Q wave, which is a kind of a pseudo Q wave in lateral and inferior leads, again indicates a DMD pathogenic variation. Multiple supraventricular ectopics, and you have a markedly prolonged PR interval. So there are many associations. So if you see these kind of ECGs, please start thinking about genetic disorder. Where we are going ahead with artificial intelligence in a big, big way. Artificial intelligence, let me tell you, if I do an ECG and I put an artificial intelligence there, it can tell me that this patient had atrial fibrillation in last 1 month. Wasn't it fabulous? This artificial intelligence, again, looking at the ECG from various parameters, we can pick up the ejection fraction, whether it's less than 35% or more, with a very, very plus 90% sensitivity and specificity. So just do an ECG and you start suspecting a poor ejection fraction with a great accuracy. So this is going to come, and early detection of dilated cardiomyopathy in a familial. Let's say, what is the importance of doing a genetic workup in a patient where you are suspecting or you have an abnormal ECGs, or this is a familial one? So you need to do a detailed genetic workup. And once you do a genetic workup, then you can follow the siblings, the children of these patients, and you can start doing a global longitudinal strain. And in case the GLS is low, then you know, you are a little more careful, you understand that this patient is likely to develop a dilated cardiomyopathy or clinical systolic dysfunction in future. So thank you very much for a kind attention.
Thank you very much, sir. Indeed, it's an excellent presentation. And so this is what actually the day-to-day echo practice, we all face the challenges when it comes to dilated cardiomyopathy. So thank you very much for giving the very insightful, informative information about the dilated cardiomyopathy. I would now call Mr. Pankaj Bhas to read a few questions for you.
Yeah, sure.
Good evening, sir. Thank you so much. It was yet another very informative and useful presentation. So with your permission, shall I read questions for you?
Please go ahead.
Okay. So the first question for the evening is, since the short axis is not taken into the consideration using heart model for LVEF, is there any increased chance of error?
No. This is heart model includes everything. It's a three-dimensional. You are actually looking at heart, not only, you know, all accesses, all three axes, short axis, everything. In fact, in case you want to, previous models of, they were also very good 3D methods where you could actually have a tomographic view or slices of the LV in a cross section, and you actually can make some changes there to improve the accuracy. But with the current use of heart model, which uses speckle tracking as a method, the accuracy is very good. We hardly need to tweak this thing. And it takes, by any other method, this is the shortest possible method of calculating ejection fraction, even shorter than MODE.
The sir mentioning about the another method of 3DF is called as a 3DQ advance.
Yes.
Where you can use the tomographic slices of LV into a 9 levels. So as when you talk about a 3D, it is all the angles are included in that. Thank you, sir. Right.
Thank you, sir. The second question is how to confirm non-compaction and increased trabeculated muscles?
I think this is a chapter in itself. There are, you know, proper guidelines, and those guidelines keep on changing. We see increased trabeculations and the non-compaction. We must have the same width of trabeculation as the compact myocardium. So it should be, the total thickness should be 50%. Of the thickness should be non-compacted, and 50% should be compacted. And if it is more than 50% non-compacted in the particular segment, it is called a non-compaction. But the guidelines, there are far more guidelines. You can use an internet resource for that.
Right. Thank you, sir. How to calculate the ejection fraction in patients with LVBB, sir?
There is no change actually in ejection fraction of LVB. If you are using a modified or Simpson's method, you can use the same method of ejection fraction. You have to actually look at the, now there where the QRS is broad, so it is preferred that you use a Q wave rather than an R wave for end diastolic frame. And ECG is very, very important for end systolic and diastolic frames because they might vary in LVB because of the variation in the contraction of various segments. Otherwise, you use 3D or you use 2D, they are almost the same. There is no difference.
All right. So the next question is how we can measure the degree of tenting and tethering of mitral wall in mitral regurgitation to determine if it can be repaired or replaced?
That is again a very nice question, and it's a nice chapter in itself. There are various calculations which we make. We make the tethering distance, we take the area under the mitral valve, and this is how we calculate. I maybe next time when I make a presentation, I would have to show you slides how to do it. Otherwise, by explaining, otherwise not be very easy for me.
All right, sir. The next question is doses of bromocriptine and when to start it, sir.
See, as of now, it is not a standard protocol to start this therapy. We are waiting for the guidelines to give us okay before we actually begin, because there are just two trials which have done, and those are small trials. We do need a large randomized trial before we begin therapy.
Okay. So the next question is, those with the history of peripartum cardiomyopathy and has delivered, ejection fraction improved but wish to get pregnant again. When will you consider to allow patient to get pregnant and do the exercise stress test?
Generally, the most of the recovery would happen in first 6 months of peripartum cardiomyopathy. So it's a good idea to do an echo after about 6 months peripartum, postpartum, and then look at the ejection fraction. So I showed you that kind of a flow diagram, where if you have ejection fraction which is still less than 55, I mean, we are sure that LV has not recovered, and having another pregnancy and exposing the patient again, because these patients do worse with the repeat pregnancy. They are unable to take the load of pregnancy, and probably prolactin, those components, 16K, produces further damage. So it's not recommended in peripartum cardiomyopathy. But in case on a follow-up, anytime you find the ejection fraction has improved more than 55%, that is normal, and then you put the patient on a stress test, and even on a stress echo, the ejection fraction improves by 10% from the baseline and does not fall or does not remain the same, and there are more parameters. And if you find that both are normal, then you can consider pregnancy in this patient. Again, there is a sizable risk, but many a times having a pregnancy is a important consideration of the family for certain important reasons. So in that condition, we can consider.
Okay. Thank you, sir. There's a question. What do you mean by septal flash and how it looks in echo?
I think I showed you the septal flash. In case you want, I can show that video again.
Yeah, and please show us again, sir.
I need to restart. Give me a minute, because I had this stopped PowerPoint. So, okay. Okay. Now, it's bouncy movement. Okay. This bouncy movement, if you see at the apex, let me make it full play, and okay, so that's a full screen. Now you see here, this is the normal septal abnormality, what you get in an LBB. It is moving towards the right ventricle when the lateral wall is contracting. That is the characteristic of LBB. But this movement, this septal, the apex moving towards the right side, this movement during systole, this apex movement towards tilting towards the lateral side is a septal bounce. All right.
Thank you, sir. The next question is, can you suggest how to proceed in a patient with AS and HOCM with echo findings?
I think for aortic stenosis, we have to calculate aortic valve area. Yesterday, we had a seminar with Dr. Samir Srivastav, and the point which was highlighted was that we still continue to see reports where aortic valve area is not mentioned, which is unfortunate, the aortic valve area should be mentioned, and that means that you are not calculating aortic valve area. In case you are not calculating aortic valve area, the decisions should not be taken on gradients, whether it's a severe AS or a mild AS or a moderate AS. The decision is based on aortic valve area. And if you do not calculate aortic valve area and you report just the gradients, then you would miss all patients of low flow, low gradient. So because there is no gradient, you've not calculated aortic valve area, so you would miss all those patients, and which is about 25 to 30% of patient after age 50. And the decision is based on asymptomatic severe AS. We still have controversies, but the threshold I personally feel should be slightly lower, because the sudden cardiac arrest incidence is high. And there are parameters in an asymptomatic AS, though the guidelines do not say that, where we should use it. In case you have a GLS less than 16, in a patient who is an asymptomatic, severe AS should be done. Otherwise, the patient with the severe AS should be symptomatic once we start doing surgery. For HOCM, the methods of treatment are very, very different. Septal ablation, resection. So I think that's a different ball game altogether.
Right, sir. There are so lots of compliments in the chat box for you, sir. And then we have another question, that is, what is the threshold to call an apex rounded?
I think it's more of a visual right now, but you know, I forgot, there is what we call as a sphericity index. That is not a rounded apex. Sphericity index is that from the bullet shape, the heart becomes longitudinal, that you take a dimension, which is a dimension in the cross section of the LV or mid LV dimension in a short axis. And then you take LV length, and if you divide this, and this is how you come to a conclusion of a sphericity index. I do not remember the figures as of now, because it's not very commonly used.
Okay, sir. The next question is, does angioplasty helps in DCM causing MR?
Yes, annuloplasty is one of the methods of improvement of mitral regurgitation, and it has been shown in trial that it does improve the functionality. But it's a big surgery. It's not a small surgery, and it has its own complications, particularly when you're talking about a patient where the ejection fraction is low and mortality or perioperative morbidity is very, very high. So we generally don't consider it as an option in dilated cardiomyopathy. It can be considered in an option in a mitral valve disease, like a mitral regurgitation. You have a mitral valve prolapse, or where there is a ring dilatation. There you can think of a repair of a mitral valve as well as a ring annuloplasty. But there are a number of methods actually tried to reduce mitral regurgitation because major problem in the mitral regurgitation in dilated cardiomyopathy, apart from the ring dilatation, is the tethering of the cordae and rigidity or a tenting of the mitral valve. So mitral annular ring would correct the problems marginally, not fully. So that is why the mitral valve clip, which is less invasive, came into practice.
Right, sir. We'll take a couple of more questions if you are okay.
I think we can take one or two, but then there are other webinars there. People might.
Yeah, like sure, sir. So there's next question. That is, which anticoagulant is the best for treatment of LV thrombus, and what is the ideal duration of treatment, sir?
The LV thrombus, you can use preferentially and to begin with, if you are treating the low molecular weight or heparin. Heparin should be an ideal choice once you are beginning the therapy, and then it can be switched over to an oral anticoagulation. Warfarin and Coumadin has been there for quite some time, but recently Novak also has been used in LV thrombus with a good success. LV thrombus, once it disappears and you have an ejection fraction or which has improved, you might consider stopping the drug. But in case the condition which actually caused thrombus at the first place is still there, that is dilated cardiomyopathy, the ejection fraction still is hovering between 20 to 25%, and then you have a spontaneous contrast there, I probably would continue NOVAC for quite some time.
Right. Probably this will be the last question for this evening, sir.
Sure.
It is for viral myocarditis, the commonest cause of DCM. Is it so?
No, not really. We initially thought the myocarditis being a cause of cardiomyopathy, but that's not true. The virus could be, still we do not know the pathogenesis of myocarditis leading to dilated cardiomyopathy, but number is not exceedingly high, number is about 20%. The myocarditis, it could, now like you are in the situation of COVID where you know that it may not be the viral infection, it could be the cytokine storm or other inflammatory markers. The virus is gone, but all those inflammatory markers actually produce a damage. So secondly, if you have a cardiomyopathy dilated and you can find the viruses, a lot of viruses have been seen in the bloodstream, but they are not the pathogenetic causes, they are just the bystanders. So true myocarditis actually happens with a very few viruses like Coxsackie, and even this COVID can do that. But proving whether it's a viral myocarditis caused by a virus, endomyocardial biopsy would be the best choice, but it doesn't constitute a very great a percentage in idiopathic dilated cardiomyopathy. Genetics, which we initially ignored quite a bit, probably plays a larger role than myocarditis.
Right. Thank you so much, sir. Before I would hand over again back to Indresh and Ranjit, I would like to mention that there are so many compliments again floating in to the chat box. Thank you so much, sir.